are here to talk about the importance of the arts in education. And I just would like to read the mission statement of the Cottage School. So the school is an unselective multicultural learning community that values and fosters the children's spirit of discovery to sustain their innate abilities and passion for learning. We create a non-competitive environment where creativity and the joy for learning are nurtured. And we have a question for you. Why do you think that children should spend time creating art?
I'm going to write down your answers.
You didn't expect to come and have a test here, right? But if you have some ideas, we're going to be talking about, of course, the skills that the arts develop, but we want to have your feedback first.
It's fun.
Yeah, it's fun, definitely.
Yes,
it
Eddie?
Completes the whole educational process. It's all part of it.
It's calming.
Yeah. It allows them to do something where they can put all their ideas into it without anybody telling them what to do. Not like a game where that's set. Something you can just start. Yes.
Sorry, it's what we have so far. So. Anybody else? So, it's fun, completes the education process, it's calming, and it allows everyone to express their ideas.
So we'll see. So art in school teaches more than how to hold a paintbrush or to recognize colors, as you can see. However, they are being devalued. In the schools, there is like a hierarchy within the school subjects where you can see the arts at the bottom, and then language arts and math at the top, and in the middle, the humanities maybe. But many of the skills and habits that are developed in the arts are similar to those that have been identified by employers as highly desirable, such as self-motivation, creativity, innovation, and cooperation. Unfortunately, the schools are not, now they're not educating for what the employers are looking for. The process of creativity and expression is one that should not be oppressed. By oppressing creativity, we are oppressing the intelligence of imagination. So let's focus on one of the aspects, one of the skills that the arts help develop, which is creativity. And we can see here the Bloom's Taxonomy of Learning, which was created in 1956 by Benjamin Bloom, who was an American educational psychologist. And he was trying to help educators understand that there is a more profound way of thinking and that education should focus into all these levels of thinking, not just remembering. But this was in 1956, where he's suggesting that we should focus into helping the students develop all these skills. And today we can see many years later that schools still focus mostly on remembering and perhaps understanding the facts. So at the Cottage School, I can give you an example where we use, or we try to use all this way of thinking. And for example, when we set up the end of the school year play, we already started the process of creating the script with the elementary school students. And so, we first start basing or asking them to brainstorm based on the facts that they have learned about this year in particular, the universe. We started with the universe. And then sometimes we use also a chapter book where they can get some inspiration from. This year we are using a book that is called
The Last of the Really Great Wang Doodles. It's by Julie Andrews.
which Liza suggested and is wonderful. And so they already started that process of brainstorming ideas. They are already in the stage of applying that into making into a script. And then they will analyze and see what parts or what ideas are the ones that they really want to use in the script. They will continue evaluating things like, for example, how many scenes they have in the play, and who is going to be playing this role. They actually help select all of the roles of the play. And they create the scenery, they help with the costumes, until the whole play comes together. And that happens really the last day, the day of the performance upstairs, because we keep editing the script and looking into problem solving, actually. They have to use problem solving a lot. I think this is possible because they are not afraid of making mistakes also. And that is so important. There is no way to create something if you're afraid of making a mistake. Because I think inventors in general also, they created many things, and maybe one of them is the one that became famous, right? We give the kids the opportunity here to feel free to create. We, of course, don't use tests, as you know, and I think in that way we allow them to use all these ways of thinking. There's another example that Liza has to show you.
Yeah, so another example of, you know, how we apply this sort of taxonomy of learning is through the game, actually, that Group 4 is producing and playing right now. So they start with facts from the curriculum, from the natural science curriculum. They chose actually to be space and the different planets. And they then describe these facts to their classmates and gather additional information that they need through discussion. They then use the information that they have to construct questions that they then in turn ask their classmates and peers, and also help them write the rules of the game that they created themselves. The students then analyze and explain the information in relation to the different components of the game. The evaluating comes in, I think, during the game, when the students answer and discuss and reframe the facts. And then finally, the combination of the self-designed questions, the self-designed game pieces, of which I have.
Oh yes, we have to show what they created.
Examples here. These are their pieces that move across the board. They all created spaceships. And of course the self-made rules, the questions are in there too, some of the questions that they made.
So in order to move from planet to planet, they have to answer questions. So they came up with the game. It's a simple game, but they are reviewing the facts and they are having fun, they're playing, and they have created something that is meaningful to them.
Yeah, it's completely, you know, immersive because they themselves have made the questions to ask their peers and are answering their peers' questions in return. And
so
it's with this peer collaboration that you kind of have this instant of complete creation.
So here there are some of the questions, for example. Oh, these are the answers.
So the back have the answers, the front have the questions.
Okay. And you saw them playing today, right? They were finishing the game upstairs.
They were finishing. But it's also great because they can go back at any time to play, whether it be later on in the year, at the end of the year, the beginning of the year, because they can just keep adding facts and making these questions. And it's something that they enjoy doing, and they, you know, they're really engaged during the process.
Mm-hmm. Enter.
There we go.
Yeah.
So then we have, how do we define the arts in education? I don't know if anybody wants to give some examples of arts in, you know, the learning environment. I have my blackboard. I can write down.
Like painting.
Exactly.
Okay.
Drawing.
Yeah. Painting. Drawing. Music.
Acting.
Acting.
Dancing.
Yeah. Dance.
Cooking is not too.
Yeah. I'm gonna write that down because that's true.
Making a bite. Or a barbecue.
It's
a barbecue.
It really
Fire.
Is an art.
It is an art. Yeah, if you use like fire.
So just quickly in review, and for those on Facebook Live, we have painting, drawing, dance, music, acting, and cooking.
I have one more to add.
Oh, yeah.
Discipline.
Discipline.
Is an art. Isn't it?
I haven't mastered it.
You have to use your imagination all the time.
Yeah,
and
no,
I'd rather dance.
Discipline can be creative.
Okay.
That's why it's an art.
Yes, yeah, because you have to actually be creative, because that, you know, you can be repeating certain things that don't work, and then you have to come up with new things. So
yeah.
You
have to trick yourself.
It's another workshop.
So, now for our purposes here, we can really categorize these arts into kind of four major categories. So we have visual arts, music, and drama and traditional dance. So there really has been only one study that has kind of given value to the role of arts in education, and it's this big study right here. It was done over the course of 10 years, and it really looks at seven different aspects of art in education, ranging from opera to after-school programs that use art specifically, like visual arts. And so the Arts Education Partnership says that the artistic experiences in young children increase motivation, skill in symbol manipulation, and enhance skill in building social relationships. The arts develop self-regulation and develop expressive skills. And that really was the conclusion of this entire study done over 10 years. But as Lauda said in the beginning, you know, unfortunately, the importance of art is really something that's hard to quantify, and as a result, is really being devalued in the current education system.
So actually, they had to do this research in order to support the arts in the schools. Like, if they were not important by themselves, you know, they develop. You know, it's great to see the schools the arts develop, but also. They should stand by themselves, not just
yeah.
because they help into the math or language arts, what we're gonna see now actually.
So some of the effects of learning in arts on academic and social skills are specifically within visual arts, you have content and organization of writing, drawing, and reading readiness. So what we do when we read nursery rhymes and poems, and then we connect that with drawings that the students make themselves, it really is actually preparing the students to read and also to work on their writing specifically. Then we have music in terms of helping with spatial reasoning, which is fundamental to understanding and using mathematical concepts and ideas. And of course, drama. So like with our play, the ability to really understand and comprehend a story and not just, you know, read something and decode it, but instead to read something and to gain understanding. And drama also helps increase peer interaction and conflict resolution skills, concentrated thought and engagement. Lauda mentioned earlier how our play really, you see a lot of problem solving coming up and, you know, collaboration on how to solve certain things and how to figure out amongst all of the students, you know, what the next step should be. And then every Wednesday we have traditional dance, so which is taught by Alvina here, and also Lauda, and that really helps with self-confidence and persistence. It helps with reading skills and nonverbal reasoning, also appreciation of group social development and social tolerance. So,
Well, does it help with reading?
With reading?
With reading, it would help at the end of the of the year. So we have performance in probably in April. I'm writing all dances in a row, so they will remember each dance. So they will read like for 2 or 3 classes to remember on performance. They don't have a list on performance.
And specifically how they develop reading skills, I'm not sure, because this is like a summary of the research, so that's what they found.
I think it's also has to do with rhythm and developing, you know, when you're reading, you're creating rhythm in your mind, like reading internally. So dancing helps, you know, different dances, you're introduced to different rhythms and different cultural rhythms too. So an arts-rich school environment really helps with creativity. You have higher engagement and higher attendance and a higher motivation to learn, which is actually something that's crucial because the learning is really self-directed as opposed to teacher and, you know, adult-directed. You have a range of personal and social developments as well as higher order thinking skills, which is what we were looking at before with the taxonomy of learning.
So one of the things dance does actually is that is you have to think very fast. You dance, right? So you have to make decisions really quick. So I'm not sure if that is related, but we can search into very specifically what they tested, you know, to do the whole research and what they found, because those are the results, so they specifically look into.
So why do the arts change the learning experience? So does anybody have any ideas to why arts would change someone's learning experience, why learning in and through the arts might affect someone's learning? Yes?
It uses a it's a different approach. It's a completely different approach to sitting down and trying to write something or read something. It's a a creative approach to the learning experience.
Yeah,
we're
performing the story.
And it's fun.
Just reading it.
Yeah,
it's nonverbal.
It's nonverbal.
Yeah.
It's not. You can teach something nonverbally with the arts, and you're gaining the same. You're gaining the result, the same knowledge, but for people who have what does Catherine have? Impaired. Where they hear but they can't make sense in their brain.
Processing auditory.
Right. Yeah, it's a process.
Yeah, the auditory processing problem. Teaching through the arts is one of the only ways to get through to those people.
That's right. Reaching people.
Patterns, and why writing is so good for somebody like that. This child who's impaired in that way can see a pattern and duplicate it and learn all sorts of things. Judgment, reaction. She can process situations. But if you were to tell her how to do it, she couldn't. She wouldn't know what you were talking about. She learns through the process of creating something.
They say images
reaction.
Are more powerful than words, right?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And they actually, we've talked in other workshops, like we're trying to make a summary here because you all know we're going to paint after, right? So we didn't want. But in other workshops about the importance of the arts in education, we talk about the two parts of the brain. And I think when you mentioned, and you both actually mentioned that, you use other resources actually.
Mm-hmm.
And by schools mostly focus on developing the left part of the brain.
Mm-hmm.
So through the arts, you're using the whole brain.
Yeah, so here we have just a quick overview. The arts provide students with authentic, connected learning experiences. And these experiences connect students' minds, bodies, and hearts in a way that is meaningful and actually tangible to them. In a traditional classroom, students are often limited to focusing on a particular skill or a particular talent. But with the incorporation of the arts, the physical act of creation provides an opportunity for a student to engage multiple skills and abilities, and instead doesn't focus on a particular skill. Secondly, engagement in the arts enables children to be critical, innovative thinkers. It supports children's problem solving, creativity, communication and expression, and experimentation while nurturing the development of cognitive, social, and personal capabilities. So students who learn in and through the arts actually become their own critics. They really rely on their own judgments as opposed to focusing or over-focusing on the critique and judgments of those around them. It's one of the reasons here that we encourage children to actually work in silence while they're creating, because it's coming from within themselves. And
we're going to encourage you when
yeah,
we go paint
exactly.
with children. That is the most challenging part when we paint with
yeah.
adults, right? But it's really a way to find your own center and have, they say, it has to flow, right?
Yeah,
so.
But as a result, I think that students are motivated to learn for the learning experience itself. And this kind of process of, you could call it self-directed learning, develops capacities for self-regulation, personal identity, and and resilience. And these are all qualities that are highly correlated with personal success, and also correlated to what Laura was talking about at the beginning of the presentation with success in the workplace later on. And these qualities that are really lacking in a lot of people that are coming out of the traditional education system with the application of the arts, you find that these are qualities that are just natural.
Mm-hmm.
So thirdly, the arts bridge gaps, and they help reach students who are not otherwise being reached and help connect students to themselves and to their peers. I think this is what you two were speaking about earlier, especially with connecting and reaching students that aren't being reached in the traditional format. This so-called arts connection functions on multiple levels, functions on a personal level and on a social level, because creating art is a personal experience, and one must draw upon your personal resources in order to generate a result. Thus, art allows for an engagement of the entire person, and by engaging the individual on a personal level, they feel invested in ways that are deeper than just knowing the answer. And that's really something that you see with the game,
mm-hmm.
as an example. The students are invested in the whole process, and it's not just getting the answers right to help them move forward,
mm-hmm.
but it's actually the act of that kind of instant of creation when what they've put together and spent so much time on comes to fruition.
Mm-hmm. So what we will look at the beginning of the presentation, when we said the employers are looking for this skill, self-motivation for
mm-hmm.
something. And then, well, creativity, we already talked about that. Innovation was another one, right? And cooperation. So they are actually developing cooperation too, even though it's the game and they're trying to get into, to land on Earth, right? That's the objective
that's the
of this game. So they have to get to Earth.
They start at Pluto. And they move backwards. But before they get to Earth, they gotta get on the moon, and then from the moon, they can hop
and
jump. Yeah.
It's fantastic.
Yeah.
So they really, I think it's an experience that they will never forget, really.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And then that leads us to finally how the art unites classroom learning with the world outside school. It facilitates a lifelong passion for learning. And that is something that is so crucial. And I feel something that's so lacking in today's traditional classroom setting. Kids go to school just to get the day over with.
Yeah.
And then they go home and they don't realize that the space around them is actually filled with other things to discover
mm-hmm.
and other things to learn. And they go to elementary school to get to secondary school, to get to college, and after college they find their job. Well, now you have to go to graduate school. And then
you find a job, and
yeah,
you're lucky if you find a job. So it's really a problem because the UK, the education system is really based in an old-fashioned model. And
exactly.
Now when we have to develop this skills because the students have to really create their own jobs, now
mm-hmm.
and in the future it's going to be, I think, more necessary because
mm-hmm.
we increase in population and technology.
Yeah.
I mean,
but if you think of, you know, a student going to school with the goal being finding a job, that doesn't leave any room for finding your passion,
mm-hmm.
finding what you're, you know, really interested in, invested in. And
mm-hmm.
ultimately, there's a disconnect between, you know, the process of learning and what your goal really should be, which is finding what you're interested in. Because if you're just regurgitating facts all day long,
mm-hmm.
you're not really, you know, internalizing the learning experience and enjoying it.
So this way of assessing the children by testing then I think generates a whole cycle that
yeah.
they are trapped into it because then they have to measure how many facts they know, fill in the blanks, pass the test because you have 300 kids, how can you test them and how can you measure if they are learning, you know? That's really the concern. Are they learning? Okay, so you measure them through tests. That's really not the reality. They are not learning, they are remembering. They are in
yeah.
the basic, very basic step of thinking. And so that is the problem because we see the consequences.
Mm-hmm.
We see the consequences, people that really cannot think for themselves, right? Students that are, and also they, I think the tendency is to be a little bit lazy about thinking or rethinking something because they get used to have the answers, and the answers have to be correct, and that's basically the only answer you can have, because otherwise you get a bad grade, right?
Mm-hmm.
So there's no even room for a mistake there or for any thinking. It's super, super old-fashioned. Hopefully we can help change this with this little school here and some other schools that also appreciate that.
Yeah. That leads us to, is it possible to educate in a different way? So
I have to
yes.
tell you, my mother said, no, Laurita, that's an utopia. I was 15, and I kept talking about it. No, there must be another way. I already had students in my house. She said, I know, I understand. And of course, she agreed with the ideas. She was my mother. But and they, my parents loved education. But she kept saying, I remember, that is an utopia, though. I don't think where you're going to find a school that brings all of this together. It's not easy, but you know, we can make a change.
But I mean, that's also an example of what we've been talking about. You find your passion and then you create something out of it. You've gathered your experiences and you've applied them to create a space where you can continue that process.
And yeah, and the passion.
Mm-hmm.
Because the passion, you know, drives by itself. It's not that you can stop it.
Exactly.
Right.
So this is actually a passage that Laura wrote in one of her essays, but I thought I would read it quickly. If education is considered a mere transfer of knowledge, the giving of information about mathematics, geography, history, language, and so forth is enough. However, if the purpose of education is to develop children as whole human beings, the arts cannot be isolated. The arts not only enrich children's lives as they are part of the culture, but they also help them to express themselves. Personal and unique expressions are shaped in paintings, in the sounds of music, in writing, in dance, and in every possible type of human expression. And this expression is necessary for life. So, education at the cottage school. We've been, you know, dropping this in and out throughout the presentation, but here we really integrate the arts and academics in all the traditional subjects. And there are no, it's like the classroom walls disappear and the walls between traditional disciplines disappear. We honor creativity in all subjects of learning, building confidence in students by allowing mistakes as a valid way to learn. And we provide daily free play time that develops the imagination.
Nobody corrected Leo that the postwar is free. I mean, I'm just saying, making a mistake. He did, Laura Sanchez did a fantastic presentation on continents. And actually, we have the postboard in the poster board in the other classroom. And he said at the end of the presentation that he got the poster board for free, right?
He thinks
and
Laura
says nobody argued with him, you know, everybody believed that. And so
he
we do give him for
it's from the business, it's free. No, we're paying for it either way.
How creative he was to end
free.
Up the whole class, the master class, saying, talking about the
yeah, and he's really impressed by that.
Yeah.
He came in talking about it too. He's like, guess what?
So that's fantastic. That's another example, special classes, how they create the whole thing
mm-hmm.
and the presentation, and we never know what they're going to do. Some students have show up without anything, and the parents are concerned. How are they going to explain this without pictures, without a book? And they have done fantastic classes, just by even asking questions, or we had one time a student that pretended to be a magician, so then he would just make things with imagination, doing the whole class, you know, just... So we don't really tell them how they have to present the class.
Mm-hmm.
It's fantastic to see what they
yeah.
can come up with, right?
We had one student this past year also do a presentation on Spain, and she came in a traditional flamenco dancing costume. And she taught the students how to dance flamenco. She taught them different moves from flamenco.
That's so much fun.
And the different hand movements and the different steps. And everyone was standing up and participating and engaged. And they probably learned the most from that presentation
mm-hmm.
through, you know, the physical act of being taught how to create just subtle hand movements and subtle
mm-hmm.
steps.
And so they will probably remember
yeah.
you know, Spain just by doing that.
Also the mm-hmm. volcano special class.
That's a very
with
popular.
With the demonstration
yeah.
of the volcano erupting.
Yeah.
You saw a video.
We have, yeah, they're fantastic. You know, they come up with different things. It's fantastic.
So that brings us to, it is our job as a society to nurture the creative minds of children. I think that's self-explanatory. Yeah, after, I mean, we've talked a lot about this throughout the presentation and how crucial it is to keep the arts alive and, you know, injected into our daily just learning curriculum and how much they actually add and enhance the whole overall learning experience.
Mm. So you can develop the creative thinking in other classes, not just the arts, but the arts helping to developing these skills.
Mm.
And about creativity, I wanted to say that Jung said that it was an instinct. So that means that we're all born with it. The problem is that we don't grow into it, but we grow out of it. We get educated out of it. Which is, it doesn't sound very optimistic, but it's really schools, you know, I don't know if you saw the video, but I recommend it. I know, Laura, you watch it, right? The King Robinson's video, he said that schools kill creativity. That's the title of the TED Talk, actually, which is wonderful. We can pass it along.
We can attach it to the...
Yeah, it is actually.
Oh,
that, when we add the PowerPoint, it will be there.
So we wanted to end on this. It looks long on the PowerPoint, but I'm going to read it. It's a book called Zen and the Art of Archery by Eugen Herrigel, and it's actually a book that Lauda had to read in school. And I think you'll see why it relates to what we're about to do in the painting in just a moment. One of the most significant features we notice in the practice of archery, and in fact all of the arts as they are studied in Japan and probably also in other Far Eastern countries, is that they are not intended for utilitarian purposes only or for purely aesthetic enjoyments, but are meant to train the mind, indeed to bring it into contact with the ultimate reality. Archery is, therefore, not practiced solely for hitting the target. The swordsman does not wield the sword just for the sake of outdoing his opponent. The dancer does not dance just to perform certain rhythmical movements of the body. The mind has to first be attuned to the unconscious. If one really wishes to be the master of an art, technical knowledge of it is not enough. One has to transcend technique so that the art becomes an artless art, growing out of the unconscious.
So let's try that when we go into painting.
Yeah.
Thank you,
guys.
Thank
you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
cheeses if you want to eat something before.